قال رحمه الله تعالى الحديث الحادي عشر عن أبي محمد الحسن بن علي بن أبي طالب صدق رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم وإحانته رضي الله تعالى عنهما قال حمدت من رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم دع ما يريدك إلى ما لا يريدك رواه الترمذي والنسائي. دع ما يريدك إلى ما لا دع ما يريبك إلى ما لا يريبك رواه الترمذي والنسائي وقال الترمذي حديث حسن صحيح.
And the author رحمه الله تعالى mentions the 11th hadith in the kitab. He says, عن أبي محمد, on the authority of Abu Muhammad, الحسن ابن علي ابن أبي طالب. الحسن ابن علي. الحسن, the son of Ali, with the son of Abi Talib. Then he mentioned, صدق رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. And صدق is the grandchild from your daughter. Your grandchild from your daughter. So الحسن was the son of Ali رضي الله عنه. And his mother was? Does anyone know? Fatima, radiallahu anha, the daughter of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So he said, Sibti Rasulillahi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He was the grandchild of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam from his daughter, wa rayhanatihi. Wa rayhanatihi is someone who was extremely beloved to him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We know about al-Hasan radiallahu anhu wa arda, that he was from one of the most beloved people to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And him and his brother Al-Husayn, they will be from the masters of the children of Jannah. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to love spending time with them. And he used to love them dearly. And he said, whoever loves them, then he loves me. So he used to classify them as a part of him sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So Al-Hasan radiallahu anhu, he narrates his hadith from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He says, حفظت من رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. I memorized from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, دع ما يريبك إلى ما لا يريبك. Leave that which causes you doubts for that which does not cause you doubts. Leave that which is doubtful for that which is not doubtful. And the hadith is in the Sunan of Imam at-Tirmidhi and an-Nasai. And he said, وقال التِرمذي and التِرمذي said, حديث حسن صحيح. The hadith is authentic, and it is as Imam at-Tirmidhi mentioned, رحمه الله تعالى. So he said, دَعْمَا يَرِيبُكَ إِلَى مَا لَا يَرِيبُكَ. Leave that which is doubtful for that which is not doubtful. Imam an-Nawawi, when he commented on this hadith, he said, this hadith is similar to which hadith that has preceded us? إِنَّ الْحَلَالَ بَيْنَّا. That when the halal is clear and the haram is clear, and between them there are matters which are not known to many people. فَمَنِ اتَّقَ الشُّبُهَاتِ فَقَدْ اسْتَبْرَأَ لِدِينِهِ وَعِرْضِهِ. Whoever leaves the shubuhat, then he has protected his religion and his honor. So this hadith, دع ما يريبك إلى ما لا يريبك, is similar to that hadith. And Imam Nawawi said it is like it stems from that hadith. The hadith of An-Nu'man radiallahu anhu. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, leave that which is doubtful for that which is not doubtful. And this is al-wara in al-Islam. Al-wara is a characteristic that the believers need to adorn themselves with. Al-wara. And the meaning of wara is to stay away from doubtful matters, fearing that you may fall into that which is haram. Al-wara' is to stay away from doubtful matters, fearing that you may fall into that which is haram. And it was a common practice of the Salaf, of the early Muslims of this Ummah, the scholars, the righteous of this Ummah, that they would leave everything which they thought was doubtful. We find Al-Fudayl ibn Iyad, rahimahullah ta'ala, he said, يَزْعُمُ النَّاسِ أَنَّ الْوَرَعَ شَدِيدٌ. The people think that wara', to have this characteristic of wara', is severe. He said, وَمَا وَرَدَ عَلَيَّ أَمْرًا. I was never faced with two things. إِلَّا أَخَذْتُ بِأَشَدِّهِمَا. Except I took the most severe of them. فَدَعْ مَا يَرِيبُكَ إِلَى مَا لَا يَرِيبُكَ. So leave that which is doubtful for that which is not doubtful. Hisham ibn Hassan, he spoke about Muhammad ibn Sirin, رحمه الله تعالى. And he said, تَرَكَ مُحَمَّدِ ibn Sirin 40,000. فِيمَا لَا تَرَوْنَ بِهِ الْيَوْمَ بَأْسَ. Muhammad ibn Sirin, he left 40,000 of the currency that they had. 40,000. And he said, this 40,000 would be something that you wouldn't consider to be a problem. And the reason why he left this is in case that money was not lawful for him. And this shows you how they were with matters which were doubtful in the religion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We also find that this hadith is one of the evidences of the main major principle of an Islam. from the qawaid al-kubra, from the major principles of Islam, is al-yaqeenu la yazulu bi-shak, that certainty is not removed by doubt. Al-yaqeen la yazulu bi-shak, from the five major principles of al-Islam, is the qaida, is the principle al-yaqeen la yazulu bi-shak, that yaqeen, certainty, is not removed by doubt. And the ulama of Islam, they said that this qaida, this principle, can be applied in almost every chapter of a person's life. Every chapter of fiqh and every chapter of a person's life. And we will take some examples, insha'Allah ta'ala. So, al-yaqeenu la yazulu bi-shak, that certainty is not removed by doubt. What does it mean that certainty is not removed by doubt? The Prophet said, da'ma yaribuka ila ma la yaribuk. Leave that which is doubtful for that which is not doubtful. Which means, leave that which you have a doubt in for that which you are certain of. So if you are certain of something, then you will go according to that which is certain, and you would leave the doubt. Similar meaning to the qa'idah, al-yaqeenu la yazulu bi-shak, that certainty is not removed by doubt. The time of salah comes, and a person now, he's about to pray, and then he thinks, am I in the state of wudu, or am I not in the state of wudu? How do we apply this qa'idah, al-yaqeenu la yazulu bi-shak? Hands up, inshallah.
No. They remember the previous hadith on wudu, or the previous salah?
So you remember your previous case that you are certain of. If you are certain now that you performed wudu, and you doubt after that that you broke your wudu, what do you do? Certainty is not removed by doubt. Therefore, your certainty is that you have wudu, your doubt is that you broke your wudu, the doubt is removed, therefore you are in the state of wudu. Now, if you are certain that you went to the bathroom to relieve yourself, but you doubt whether you did wudu after it or not, you cannot remember. What is it now? Here the certainty is that you do not have wudu. And the doubt is that you have wudu. So the doubt is removed. So that means you are not in the state of wudu. You have to perform wudu. So this is with regards to tahara. A person now, when it comes to salah, he is praying salah, and now the shaitan has whispered to him, have I prayed 2 raka'at or have I prayed 3 raka'at? He's in doubt now. Have I prayed 2 raka'at or have I prayed 3 raka'at? So the certainty is what? 2 raka'at or 3 raka'at? 2. He's certain in both cases that he's prayed 2. And he's doubtful if he has prayed the 3rd raka'ah or not. So he removes the doubt as if he has only prayed 2 now, and then he continues the salah, and then he can perform the sujood of forgetfulness at the end. So he goes according to that which he is certain. So if he is unsure now, have I prayed 3 raka'at or 4 raka'at? The certainty is how many raka'at? 3. And the doubt is the 4th. So you remove the doubt which is the 4th, and you build on the 3 raka'at, and then you perform the 2 raka'at. And the 2 sujood of forgetfulness at the end of the salah. When it comes to zakah, a person now, at the time of giving zakah, maybe he's given charity throughout the year. And then the 1 year is about to finish for his zakah, and he asks himself, did I give it with the intention of zakah, or did I give it with the intention of sadaqah? This could happen. And this happens to many people. Because you're allowed to give your zakah early. Like the Prophet ﷺ, when he gave the zakah on behalf of Al-Abbas, his uncle radiallahu anhu, he said, this is his zakah, and this is his zakah for the following year. So the scholar said it's permissible to give zakah early. So now a person, he is in doubt. Did I give my zakah early or did I not give it? Was it zakah or was it sadaqah? The default position is what? That he hasn't given anything. Correct? So now he has a doubt now. The doubt that was it zakah or not. So what is the certainty? That he hasn't given zakah. And the doubt is that he has given zakah. Therefore it is removed and he still has to give zakah. Zakah is still obligatory upon him. A person comes in Ramadan, he's about to break the fast. He looks at the time, he's unsure if the time is correct. He couldn't hear the mu'adhin. He is certain that what? He's certain that he is fasting. And he has doubted that the time of Maghrib has come. Therefore the doubt is removed and he is still fasting until he can prove that the time of Maghrib has come. You can use this qa'idah in every chapter of fiqh. You go to Hajj, you are performing tawaf. Have you done 5 circuits around the Kaaba or 6? The certainty is 5. The doubt is 6. You remove the doubt, you act as if you have done 5, and you build upon it. You have gone to the Jamarat. You are throwing stones at the Jamarat. Have you thrown 3 stones or 4 stones? The certainty is 3 stones. And the doubt is 4 stones. And therefore the doubt is removed, and the certainty is kept and acted upon, and therefore you have only thrown 3 stones. And this works on every bab of fiqh. So this qa'idah, al-yaqeenu la yazulu bi-shak, is from the major principles of the Sharia of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And one of the evidences for this, not the main evidence, but one of the evidences for this is this hadith, دَعْمَا يَرِيبُكَ إِلَى مَا لَا يَرِيبُكَ. The main evidence that they use for it is the hadith of Abdullah ibn Zayd ibn Asim al-Mazini, which is in the Sahihain. شُكِيَ إِلَى النَّبِيَّ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ الرَّجُلُ يُخَيَّلُ أَنَّهُ يَجِدُ الشَّيْءَ فِي الصَّلَاةِ. A man, he complained to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that he felt something in the salah. He wasn't sure if he broke his salah or not. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "La yansarif hatta yasma'a sawtan aw yajida riha." The person should not break his salah until he hears something or he smells something, to show that the asl is that you haven't broken your wudu. The default position is that you haven't broken your wudu. The certainty is that you are in salah and you have wudu. The doubt is whether you have broken your wudu or not. If it is only a doubt and it is not certainty, or you do not have any side evidence to support it, you remove the doubt and you build upon that which is certain. So this is the hadith of al-Hasan radiallahu anhu arda, that certainty is not removed by doubt. We also find from this that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam wants us to be certain of our actions. And he doesn't want the whispers of the shaitan to affect us. He doesn't want the whispers of the shaitan to affect us. Because if a person now was to just work and think about the doubts, then the shaitan will come to him again and again and again. And that's why we find some of our brothers and sisters, they are affected with waswas. That they may be performing wudu and it takes them half an hour or an hour to perform wudu. They will pray salah and they will repeat the salah again and again and again. And this is why they need to implement the qa'ida. Firstly, certainty is not removed by doubt. However, if they are people who continuously face waswas, then the ulama say, do not pay attention to any doubt and act as if the doubt wasn't there. So if a person now he completes the salah, I wasn't sure if I had wudu. If you're someone who always faces this, you act as if, yes, I had wudu and I'm not going to pay attention to the doubt. You never give in to the doubt and you always fight the doubt and you keep making dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We also find from this hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that how he used to educate the children. As al-Hasan radiallahu anhu was a child, and he memorized this from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So some people think that knowledge is only for those who grow old, or knowledge is only for the adults. But the children used to attend the gatherings of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and they used to memorize from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. As you find one of the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam of a companion, and I can't recall his name now, but he said, I have memorized from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, majjatan majjaha fi wajhi. I remember from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam when he put water in his mouth sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And then he blew it on the child's face. And he said, and I was a very young child, and he mentioned his age, and I can't recall the age right now. But he shows you how the Prophet used to teach the young children. And he used to spend time with them. Like we will come to the hadith of Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu, which is an amazing hadith which speaks about the qadr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And in this hadith, the Prophet said, Ya Ghulam, he's speaking to a young child. He's speaking to a young boy, and he's teaching him about the qadr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when he lives his life, he will live it according to the sharia of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. How he used to teach children, and this is also what we can derive from this hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We also find from this hadith how the sharia of Allah jalla wa ala wants us to try and find a sense of peace and tranquility in our heart. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has told us to avoid doubtful matters. Because if you avoid doubtful matters, then you will be in a sense of peace and ease. But if you fall into doubtful matters, you will be in a sense of worry. And maybe 5 years down the line or 10 years down the line, you will start to question that which you did. Especially if it comes to major affairs like your marriage. A person will get married and then he'll start having doubts. Was my marriage halal? Was it permissible for me to get married in this way? And then that's why whenever anyone comes to a marriage, say, send them to the Sharia Council. Because if you send them to the Sharia Council, no doubts can ever come in their mind after, because the judge will write something and he'll say, this is the Shari ruling that is given to you. If your marriage wasn't halal, then this is how to make it halal. And they will discuss the matter like this. But the Prophet ﷺ and the Sharia of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it wanted us to have a state of ease and peace and tranquility in our hearts. And therefore anything which was doubtful, we get it rectified. We leave that which is doubtful and we go to that which is certain. We leave the certainty is not removed by anything which is doubtful. If we ever have a doubt of anything, we get it verified immediately, so the doubt doesn't wander with us and the doubt doesn't linger with us for years to come, and then we start to question, was our marriage valid or was it not? Was our marriage valid or not? Or was my income halal or not? And we do not question these things. No.